Father. Today we have a distinct privilege here in Loma Linda. One of the leading scientists in the world, and I think one of the leading scientists in the Adventist Church as well, is visiting us today from South Africa. Professor Walter Veith has been actively involved with the Amazing Discoveries Ministry, and he has a vast vast knowledge about I'm gonna dare to say pretty much everything. he has a wide expertise. He has expertise in several areas, and he speaks particularly on creation evolution. But your research was in health and nutrition and health as well, right? So, without further ado, I'm just gonna introduce Professor Veith. But before we're gonna pray.
Thank you, Brother Miguel. Can we all pray together? Bow our heads and close our eyes. Heavenly Father, we pause to thank you for the blessing of today. We thank you for the privilege we have to learn more of you and prepare ourselves for greater service and the finishing of this work. We want to thank you for bringing your servants here safely, Pastor Francois and Dr. Veith. We thank you that you created this opportunity, this window of time, for them to be here and for them to speak to us. I pray that your spirit will descend upon this place and upon these men and Dr. Veith as he speaks to us even now. We ask that these words will be words of life and truth, and that, Lord, indeed it will spark a revival and reformation first in our own hearts and upon this campus, especially, Lord, as we see the day approaching. Come by and be with us now, we ask. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Hi, everyone. I had nothing to do with arranging these meetings, but I gathered that it was going to be in the format of questions and answers. And if something comes up that requires a little bit of more information, then we can use the PowerPoints and show you one or two things. That's why I've set it up. So the ball is in your court. What do you want to talk about in terms of science and revelation or whatever? Yes.
Wait a minute.
Well, I don't know how different this is going to be from what you were ready to talk about, but just because of what I was doing as a freshman studying biology undergrad in Andrews University, I was able to be there at the last session that this one of the three teachers that we had in biology gave, because after that, he was ousted from Andrews University for his stance on evolution. And now I found out that he's one of the deans of one of the schools here at Loma Linda University, and I know that it's not only him, but other people that may, because of his position, may try to coerce some students into doing some things that they may not be feel comfortable with in terms of writing papers or in terms of what will be their views concerning what we this campus should believe on or should be completely agreed on in terms of creationism, being that there's not too many places in the world that would be so forward when it comes to that. So how do we deal with that? It's just a question to throw out there.
With great difficulty, my brother. Most of you, do you know that I was an evolutionary scientist and an atheist? You're all aware of that? Yeah. And today I'm in a creationist, and I believe every single word in the Word of God. There's nothing that I don't believe. Much that I would like more answers on. But every time I was really skeptical, God always put me on the floor with a knockout blow And I had to admit he was right and I was wrong. It rather irritated me because I would also like to be right just once. But he's always right, isn't it? He always wins. And it's always best for me. And yes, it is a crisis. I taught at an Adventist college the science, faith and science course for many years. And sometimes I would not be able to because of other commitments. I mean, I had a full-time university professorship, so it was hard. And then someone else would take over and teach exactly the opposite. Now, if you want to see confusion, that can do it. And we're going to have that until the close of time. God permits apostasy within his own ranks, so that people can come to a conclusion and make decisions as to where they stand in terms of the debate. And there will always be hooks to hang your doubts on. There'll always be some little point, but look at the greater picture and ask yourself, is there enough evidence that God's word is true? Not only drawing from the scientific aspects, but from the totality of the Word of God. If I had to say science alone convinced me, I would be lying. Science alone didn't convince me. I had to add prophecy to the scale. And then I had to add personal experience to the scale. Then I had to add doctrine to the scale. And eventually, in its totality, the one outweighed my skepticism. And when I had many questions, and I said, you know, I have many questions, and I'm a facts man. I need the facts. I need to know. God in his grace brought me to this very place. This was 24 years ago. And the head of geoscience at that stage, I just saw him a second ago. Gray little man. Ariel Roth, who knows him? He was head of geoscience. And he and Harold Coffin, you remember him? You know Harold Coffin? He took me out. They took me out into the field. And I could bounce many of my questions off them for 2 weeks. And discuss the things that really bothered me on a geological level. And then after that, skepticism in our own ranks was the stimulus for me to investigate. And I was a scientist working in nutritional science, and one of the issues was the lion. Surely that is a beast designed to kill, and where do you come with this ridiculous notion that all animals ate plants, and his anatomy and his gut and all of these issues. And I made it my point to do some research on gut length and the effect of diet, etc., etc., and health and parameters of blood. I had students working on these things, and you know what? It was just fantastic. There is so much evidence, if you want to look for it, that God's word is true. And how I got here in the first place is also a fascinating story. 24 years ago or whatever it was, I just started at the university. I'd left the university, my previous university, because I became convicted on issues of evolution and creation. And I could no longer reconcile my faith with what I was teaching at the university, and we had a law. And the biology department at the university where I was, that we had to teach everything in the parameters of the evolutionary paradigm. So I couldn't give a physiology course without saying what the origins thereof were. I had to include origins on every single biochemical reaction that I would teach, totally steeped in evolution. I resigned. And I thought, that was the end of it. I'll never get back into university. I'm the pariah. I mean, who wants a zoologist who's a creationist? But another university appointed me, and I became professor there for 15 years in the zoology department. But when I just entered in, I came in by the back door because someone didn't want to work for such a low salary. I got that post, but a few years later, I was the professor of that university. God works in mysterious ways, but I just started working. And I got this invitation to come to Loma Linda and to go into the field with those men, Ariel Roth and Harold Coffin and all those guys that were there at that stage. And I couldn't go. I mean, you don't walk into a university and go to the professor and say, excuse me, I want to be away for 2 weeks. But South Africa was in turmoil. We had, you know, the switchover from the previous regime to the next regime. And there were riots, and they were throwing stones, and they threatened to burn down the universities. And it was chaos. And it broke out exactly when that invitation came. And the university was forced to close for 2 weeks. But what is interesting, all staff had to remain at the university. Nobody was allowed to leave. The university was closed for students because they'd written exams and the riots came in the middle of the exams. But anybody whose exams were finished could go. Now, my exams were scheduled right towards the end. I had no hope of going. And then I can't even remember the details. It's a long time ago. There was another crisis, and the exams had to be relocated, and my students wrote first. So my students had completed their work, and I was the only one on the entire staff of the university who didn't have students that still had to write exams. So I went to the professor. I said, what do I do now for the next 2 weeks? He said, I don't care. Go to the moon. So I came to Loma Linda. God is good. And that served me in my stead. So, yes, you'll have to deal with that. And you'll have to make your own mind whether you believe what God says or whether you believe what some scientist says. And if he's afraid of his standing in the scientific world, well, then so be it. At this very university, I spoke to some scientists, and they said to me, please don't make our name the laughing stock of the world. We want to still be recognized by the scientific world. And if you come up with this straight evolution versus creation talk and you take a stand for a short chronology, you are making our name the pariah on the planet. And this wasn't now. I'm talking about 20 years ago. So it was there then already. And I said to that person, well, what's your big problem? And he said, well, you have to adopt longer chronologies. I said, how long do you want the chronologies? He says, well, at least 100,000 years. Not this short chronology. And I said to him, excuse me. This is a leading people. I said, excuse me. The scientific world teaches that we're here for 4.5 billion years. That evolution of microorganisms started 2.5 billion years ago. Macroevolution, as we see it today, is in the fossil record 600 million years. And you come with 100,000 years, they're going to laugh you out of town. They're going to think you're a moron. And the Bible says short chronology, 6,000 years. And you don't want to be there because you don't want to be ridiculous in the eyes of science? Well, now you're ridiculous in the eyes of God and ridiculous in the eyes of science. Choose one of the two chairs. Sit on this one or that one. So this is not a new problem. It's an old problem. Sorry for the long answer. The choice lies where? This is where the choice lies.
Miguel, you want to go ahead? All right. Hi, Dr. Veith. I just had a question about how starlight fits into a short chronology.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, what are the heavens? The heavens consist of three possibilities. The atmosphere, right? So you have this lower heaven, which is the atmosphere. Then you have the starry host. And then you have the place where God lives. Paul was elevated into the third heaven. Which of the heavens did he create in those 6 days? Was it this one down here, the atmospheric one, or the stars? If you go to the fourth day, the text, he created the stars also, is a parenthetical sentence. It doesn't mean that he created them necessarily 6,000 years ago. That always bothered me. Why did God create in the first place? I mean, if he's been a God of eternity, there's plenty of time, right? That's a lot of time, eternity. And then all of a sudden, 6,000 years ago, in all this eternity, he decides, time for something new. And here we are. Why? Are we some kind of afterthought? Did he get bored, or did he only get round to us now, or what's his problem? And then I read in the Psalms that he ordained out of the mouth of babes us to silence his enemies. In other words, there was a rebellion in mindset where Lucifer challenged God. And he challenged God on the level of his rulership over his creation and having a set of norms and rules to be adhered to in order not to have chaos. And he was challenged on that level because the theology was, we're all holy. We have that theology in the world today as well. We're all holy. And so God answered this problem by creating this earth. And he pushed the stopwatch. And he gave a specific block of time to deal with the sin question. And the solution to the sin question is you. You're the solution. Because he created you different to any other organism in the entire planet. So a long answer to your question. I'm getting there. But when we were created, did the stars and the sons of God sing together, yes or no?
Yeah.
They must have been there. Adam, son of God, created being, he must have been there. Not Adam, but the other sons of God. They must have been created beings. But God shared something with this planet that he shared with none other, and that was, be fruitful and multiply and have dominion. Nobody else had that. They were all subject to God. And now, by sharing in his creative capacity and bearing responsibility, we could better understand the mindset of a God who has rules and regulations and order so that it doesn't revert to chaos. So you're the answer to that problem. Did he know you were going to fall? Yes. He knew you were going to fall. Did he bear it lightly? No, he took it upon himself. I like that kind of God. Yeah. I like that kind of God. And so, those stars and those other things out there, were they necessarily created along with this universe, as many creationists claim? Or could they have been there beforehand? I think they could have been there beforehand. But this earth is a new creation. Maybe the solar system, maybe the galaxy. Whatever it takes to have this earth in planet is new. Now you will say, but it takes millions of years for the light to reach here. So is God reliant upon a body of light in order to generate light? Huh? No. Doesn't the Bible say he is light? Didn't he say, let there be a sun so that I can have light? No, he said, let there be light. So the fact that there are, that there's photonic energy is not reliant upon an object, it's reliant upon God. If God then chooses to place an object to generate photonic energy, that's fine. There's a lot of evidence that the speed of light has been declining. Empirical evidence, even with the same instruments, and that there's been a rapid decline. So maybe things were a lot faster, maybe things have been slowed down, maybe we've been isolated so that we cannot escape from this planet. We'd love to escape, but we're not going to get away. Because sin has been encapsulated, and the game is going to play itself out here. Even the fallen angels are down here, isn't that so? So I don't know whether it answers your question.
I know you had a question. If perhaps the second heavens or the third heavens were not created in those six literal days, how do you explain death in the universe, dying stars, or in that aspect?
All right. Do you understand the dynamics of nutrition? Do plants have to die in order for you to live? Don't you shove them in your mouth and digest them? All right. Now, plants are not classified as life, but they are living. Any biologist will tell you that it's living food, isn't that so? But the life will be in the blood. Now, they don't have blood. Neither do they have a nervous system. And they were created on the third day. They are food, living food. And as I partake of living food, I actually assimilate it into my living entity. So in a sense, it doesn't die. But it is a process that is required in order to generate something. Now, nobody has ever seen the birth of a star, and nobody has seen the death of a star. All we see is what we conjecture to be the death of a star, a supernova, because the theory requires the death of a star to add the nuclear fusion components to the universe in order to gather together planets that can make organic life possible. Nobody's ever seen it. It's just part of a theory. And if I look at cycles and turnovers, then why should the universe be any different? Cannot there be a cycle that we do not fully understand, which generates and regenerates and fades and gives? So don't be too hung up by what science says in order to fit in with its Big Bang theory.
Does the fossil record provide evidence of a great deluge?
Okay, let me look for a slide. Evolutionary processes require, by definition, advancement from simple to complex. That's okay. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
There's no other way, right? Would you agree that evolutionary processes require development from small to large? Would you agree with that? All right, let me elaborate a little bit because you're so quiet. If life is going to, by chance, develop in some slime pond and some chemicals come together, is an elephant going to jump out of the pond, or are you perhaps going to get to an amoeba? Is that small or is it large? It's small. So evolutionary scientists talk about the law of Carroll. Everything has to advance from small to large. You can't start with large, because that requires a level of complexity that not even the most ardent faith exponent of evolution will be able to follow, right? So it goes from small to large. The third criterion, if there was no life on this planet and somehow fortuitously it came into existence in one place, then the initial diversity of life must have been very low on this planet, and it must have increased to a larger diversity. Would you agree with that? Has to be. There's no other choice. Those are the three absolutes where there's no leeway this way or the other. What do we have? We have irreducible complexity. The biochemical processes to make something a living organism are so complicated that it boggles the mind. You take a biochemistry course and you study them one at a time, the glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, the whatever. Every single creation or biochemical process in the body is highly complex. Citric acid cycle, the urea cycle, the this cycle, the that cycle, and every single one of them is required for life. That means the very simplest organism has all those complex cycles in order to qualify for the word life. That means that the human being and the elephant in each cell has exactly those same processes. Now, if they are all present in the human being and the elephant, how did they get there? They're also present in the simplest, if there is such a word, of all organisms. That means everything must have been there from the beginning. The only other alternative is parallel evolution, that it evolved over and over and over and over again. Given the complexity and the genetics involved, forget it. They have to be related to this process called life. So, in order to live, there's an irreducible complexity. You cannot get it by increment. You either have it or you don't. So there is no advancement from simple to complex. It doesn't exist. Nowhere in the universe does it exist. Or on Earth, at least. When it comes to development from small to large, you look at the paleontological record. That's what you were speaking about. What do you find? You find large to small. You look at any creature in the paleontological record, and it's a factor X larger than anything related today. Every single creature, dragonflies with 2-foot wingspans, like helicopters. Yes. You look at all the lizards. You look at any creature. Now, why would they be so much larger if the law of Carroll says we start small and go big? The fossil record should have all the smaller ones and the lower levels and the bigger ones later. We have a reverse sequence. Thirdly, we have reverse diversity. Now, evolution teaches that life is fortuitous. It starts somewhere. And then the diversity must become more and more. You don't have that. You have a massive diversity right in the Cambrian explosion. Every phylum is there. With varieties that absolutely boggle the mind. We have a fraction left of what there was. A fraction. Now, I want you to think further along those lines. What's the driving force of evolution according to the scientific world? Natural selection. Natural selection is a useless god. In fact, some of the scientific literature actually refers to natural selection, and some of the old evolutionists almost refer to it, and sometimes literally refer to it, in inverted commas, of course, as the god, the driving force of the evolutionary process. Natural selection, by the very nature of the word, is precisely that. Selection. Selection of what? It can only be a selection of something that is there, right? And if you're going to have a survival of the fittest in terms of that selection, then that obviously means that there is a fit and a non-fit. Isn't that so? So you have to have two options that are there in order for natural selection to operate. Now, excuse me, where did it come from? Did natural selection create anything? No. It only selects between options that are already there. So it's not a good god. It cannot create ex nihilo. It cannot speak and it stood fast. It can only select between what is already there. Now here's the next problem. Natural selection is supposed to have brought about this massive diversity that we have on our planet by natural selection. But what does the process do? It chooses the fit to the detriment of the non-fit. That's where extinction comes in. So natural selection cannot create anything. It can only choose between options that are already there. And once the selection process is over, you go from a minimum of two to what? To one. How can a process that makes less and less make more and more? So how do you explain the reverse sequence? You cannot. Now, they'll show you the paleontological record, and they'll show you all these strange creatures, and they'll put on all that flesh. Based on what?
Imagination.
A pretty good one. Based on bone fragments, right? They'll show you in a book on the Cretaceous or whatever, or on the early tertiary, they'll show you all these elephants with short trunks, long trunks, medium trunks, whatever. They'll show you that everything goes from small to large. You look at any evolutionary tree in any textbook, what will you find? A progression from small to large. Any evolutionary tree. Take the evolution of the horse. You start with the ones at the bottom, Hyracotherium, and you go on, later called Eohippus, and you go all the way up to Equus. Excuse me, they were all contemporaneous. They all come out of the same fossil record. They come out of the mindset of the scientist. So the fossil record, initially, as a scientist, you know, would have confused me. But when I was an evolutionist, I was, well, here's the evidence, if you don't believe me, that during the past decade, this comes from the journal Nature, the past decade, however, the discovery and development of another fauna of marvelous preserved soft-bodied Cambrian organisms at Qingying in China has proven that full diversity was reached within the explosion itself. Good grief, they call it the Cambrian explosion. That means every single organism, category of organisms that you can think of was there from the beginning. Is that creation or is that evolution? Surely that's creation. Now, I used to be a gradualist which is a school of thinking based on Darwinism. The only school that makes any sense whatsoever, gradualism. But I had to change my view, and I had to become a punctuated equilibriumist. Because everything was there at the same time. You've probably seen this in one of my lectures, but this is interesting stuff. Natural selection has another problem. It cannot operate at the level of the genotype, it can only operate at the level of the phenotype. So whatever happens at the level of the genotype has to happen by chance. And whatever happens at the level of the phenotype, well, that can be subject to natural selection. So if we had to simplify that, a book of instructions dealing with how this aeroplane has to be constructed. If this were evolution, that would be the genotype. And that would be the phenotype. Now, I can only determine how this aeroplane flies once it's been built, right? So today we have very elaborate systems of models, etc., making sure the thing flies before we actually put a pilot into it, and then we pay him a fortune and we call him a test pilot because he could just fall, right? So how did this book come about? Who wrote this book? Well, logically speaking, if you want to build this airplane, who wrote the book of instructions on how to build it? A designer, right? But when it comes to evolution, who wrote the book? Chance. Chance wrote the book. It had to be fortuitous reactions that came together. And the probabilities are so mind-boggling that, you know, for all intents and purposes, it's a non-entity. But let's go further. Let's say, for example, the probability of the book of instructions coming about actually took place. And you have the book of instructions. Wow. In other words, by pure chance, all the information about who and what an organism is, and finally you are, came about by evolutionary processes by chance. If I have the book of instructions on how to build the aeroplane, how long do I have to wait before the book finally produces the aeroplane? I think millions of years are not sufficient. Let's say it really happened and I put the book on my shelf. How long do I have to sit and wait for the aeroplane to appear? It's not enough to have the information to get the book to appear. The mechanism to translate the book into the airplane also has to appear. And that mechanism is far more complex than we can even imagine. Every student will tell you that in biology it's the transcription process, right? It's opened up the book, and then a photocopy is made, which is called RNA. And that RNA has to be taken outside to a factory which has to exist, the ribosome, has to attach to the ribosome. There have to be enzyme systems, machinery available to transcribe that into a protein. There must be a machinery available to bend that protein into the shape that you need. That protein must be an enzyme which must catalyze. It's mind-boggling before you finally get something. Is that subject to natural selection? No, you have to wait for the aeroplane to appear to know whether it'll fly or not. You really need a lot of faith to believe that natural processes did this. Okay, any other questions?
So there is evidence in the fossil record, and it takes more faith to believe in evolution than it does in creation.
Absolutely, you have to have faith. Amen. When I was an evolutionist, the only reason why I didn't take the step to Christian. I took the step from gradualism to punctuated equilibrium, no problem, because the fossil record demanded it. Yeah. There was no intermediary. Everything was there at the same time. This must have been evolution at supersonic speed, like Stephen Jay Gould called it at that stage.
Yes.
So I had to become a gradualist. But why didn't I take the step to creationist? Because I would have to acknowledge God. And that was something which was worse than anything I could handle. Because I had an abhorrence for God. Now, why did I have an abhorrence for God? Exactly. Because of theology. I abhorred God because of theology. Because I was told that God was a monster. He'd roast you forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever on his whim. And that was a wrong theology. So, yes, there's evidence in the fossil record, the whole fossil record. Speaks of
yes,
of creation. Let me just point out, if I don't know whether I have it in this one. Let me see. No, not in this one. Do I have it up there? No, I don't have it anywhere in that one. Eh?
I.
All right. Let me just one point still. Evolution has to deny a universal flood. It has to.
Why?
Because if you have an evolutionary process and you're developing up your evolutionary tree, one organism after the other evolves over time, and now finally you have the full diversity of everything on the planet, including man. And now you're going to come with a universal flood and destroy everything that lives on terra firma. That means you've destroyed every life form on the planet that lives on solid land. And today it's all here. What does that mean? It means that your evolutionary process from that point should have started again until you get to the evolution of man. Are you with me? So if I break the process of evolution with a total destruction in a universal flood, then I've broken the continuity of the evolutionary development. I have to start evolution all over again. And that's not tenable. So science denies the universal flood, period.
But they don't seem to mind meteor-based
annihilation. No, but it's always local. It's always local. And theistic evolutionists will go along with the local flood. Now, Noah, as I always say, must have been a moron to build a boat and take all the animals in the boat to save them from a local flood if he could have just run to higher ground and had the animals over there anyway, right?
That's right.
He should have been able to move and figure that one out, right?
That's right.
Now, is there a Cretaceous layer which is universal, stretching from continent to continent on the same base rocks, yes or no? Yes.
Yes. Yes.
That one point alone shows that the whole world was underwater at the same time. If the whole world was underwater at the same time, then evolution is impossible. Just that one point. One of my colleagues, I won't mention his name, Francois, you know him very well. He sits in church on a Sunday, and he's an evolutionist. He's the paleontology professor at one of our universities. I studied with him. We were honor students and graduates together. And I said to him, you're sitting in church, and you teach paleontology and evolution, and you have a problem with the universal flood. Explain it to me. He says, there was no universal flood. I know. I said, I studied with you. I know what we teach. But I want to know why you're sitting in church. Because Jesus said, and the flood came and took them all away. I actually have him on tape. Because I had a little tape recorder in my pocket. I'm sneaky. And his answer was, Jesus was ignorant or lying.
Wow.
Yeah, but he sits in church.
Wow.
So if you can twist your mind around that one, well, then you can be anything. Don't let yourself be duped into thinking there's no evidence for creation. A universal chalk layer means a universal flood. Period. There's no argument about it. There's no way around it. And all of those points that I put on just now, we haven't had time now to talk about radiometric dating and all of these things. They're all based on assumptions. You have to make certain basic assumptions because no stone that you ever break open has a clock in it. It only has a ratio of parent and daughter elements in it. And whether those parent and daughter elements have always been in that particular ratio, whether it has been a closed system, or whether the clock has ever been set to zero, that's pure conjecture and theory. So nobody can tell you this earth is old or this earth is young based on those criteria alone. But let me wrap up. Natural selection is the very worst driving force you can envision for change and evolution. Number two, the fossil record speaks of an explosion where every single form of phyla was present right from the beginning. That's totally contrary to evolution. The diversity was enormous in the past, and the size relationships is reversed to what you must expect. And then there is a universal chalk layer saying that the whole world was underwater at exactly the same time. And if those points aren't enough for you to at least investigate the possibility that the Bible is true, then there is nothing anybody, including God, can do for you. Yes, sir.
I did a recent presentation, and some of the colleagues asked me afterwards, yes, but you ignored the challenges presented by the obvious issues raised by the Adventist theistic evolutionists. And I'm thinking, yes. And there was a reason why I avoided it. Because I wish to deal with clean water and not go into the muddy one. But I was wondering how you deal with these. Because people have this feeling that just because they have interpreted things in their own minds in a certain way, that the argument sounds interesting or at least plausible, that it must be legitimate.
Right. I have a question for you. Does the Word of God have to come down to your level of understanding, or do you have to come up to the level of understanding of the Word of God? That's the first point. Now, I have sat in the committees, in the faith and science committees, in all of them. Well, not all of them, but most of them, all the big ones. Including, well, I wasn't in the North American ones, but I was in the GC ones, and I was in my own division ones. So I was here in the States in the GC ones, and I was over there. And you were there?
No.
You weren't there. And there we had to listen to exactly the things that you are talking about. And I'm so grateful to those people because as a consequence, I worked out entire new lecture series to deal with those issues. They were an inspiration to me. But I must agree that some of the ideas that you come across are so painful.
It is painful, yes. It's yeah. Agonizing.
Yes. It's like thank you. I have very close sympathies as far as that is concerned. It's so well put, because just yesterday I had a root canal and I think I'm dying. It is very sad when you see how our scientists will compromise on these issues just for a momentary glory of acceptance with the world. It is so sad to see it.
But they don't realize that the world doesn't care about their perceived prestige.
Exactly.
Respect and all that.
The world doesn't care about
it. They're all busy elbowing each other. So how are they going to be respectful of someone else?
Well, I've been in science most of my life, and I've learned in the scientific world to wear my armor on my back. Yes, you have to decide for yourself. There's no way that anybody can decide this issue for you. You have to decide for yourself. And God, as I said in the beginning, permits apostasy even in our own ranks. And if necessarily, allow the apostasy to progress to such a point that even a frog with Alzheimer will be able to discern between right and wrong. Our time is up?
No.
Not yet. Good. Good. What other questions do you have?
Are you here tomorrow?
Yes. I'm not. Am I not speaking somewhere?
No, here tomorrow.
Here?
Here?
Here tomorrow. For the which students?
Same time.
Okay, good. I just have a question. Could you also, in your presentation, include some information on genetic variants and the question which there is today on so-called, well, it used to be called junk DNA or non-coding DNA, which
there's no such thing as junk DNA.
There's no such thing. That's okay. That's okay. To address that issue, how to explain certain of those similarities which there are between certain primates and man in that non-coding DNA?
Yes.
That would be interesting.
Now, you know, I always use the example. When it comes to the similarities, life is based on similar processes, right? We all have the exact same biological composition in terms of our protein composition, our recognition glycoprotein composition, our cellular membrane composition. That means there must be huge similarity in the gene pool between various organisms. And this similarity is then used to confirm an evolutionary continuity and relationship between the various organisms. And the favorite one is always, we share 98% of the genes with a chimpanzee. Isn't that the favorite one you always hear? But they never tell you that you share 95% of the genes with a mouse, or that you share 78% of the genes with a banana.
That's a good relationship.
That's a good relationship, isn't it, sir?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you could be eating your relatives, your ancestors. And if you look at the question of genetic expression, take a caterpillar. It's the best example there is. A caterpillar and a butterfly. Everybody must admit they're vastly different, isn't that so? And yet the genetic composition of the caterpillar includes the entire working genome of the butterfly and vice versa. So how did that terrific diversity in the gene pool come about? It must be built in. Did it come about by evolution? Hardly likely, because the probability of just one gene with 300 nucleotides coming together is 10 to the power of 127. That's more than the particles in the entire universe. You got excited.
Yes, something really struck me at this point as you're talking about this. Some of the best ideas come to me during discussions like this. You know. It occurs to me that a good dictionary has all the good words that we use, well, essentially in the English language, regardless of what we are discussing.
Yes.
But the dictionary does not determine the subject of discussion, does it?
No.
So what if the genes are not unlike the words in the dictionary? They do not determine the subject matter that is composed with them.
I like your paradigm.
You know what I'm saying? You could be doing Shakespeare, or you could be doing what's Dr. Oz, or you know, whatever. You know. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Yes.
Or you could be talking about the Bible. You know, using same words, you could be saying something profound or something deplorable. It doesn't really determine. The genes don't determine the topic.
No.
They only give you the tools to express yourself.
That's right.
Doesn't that sound like an insightful thought?
You can take it a step.
Pardon me?
But I'm interested in the non-coding DNA, because it's clear, if something is expressed, it's probably very similar. But the question that I have, because I'm discussing it with people as well, how to deal with non-coding DNA, which is very similar between certain types of primates, and they make their calculations. They say, well, as we expected, chimpanzees are most likely to us, and orangutans are further away. So we have certain patterns in the non-coding DNA, which is not responsible for gene expression. And it's more similar between chimpanzees and humans. And a bit further away, you have gorillas and so on. And the question is, and the idea is, that these are remnants, quite a few. About 50% of it is supposed to be remnant viruses, which in time, some of them became transposons. So the question is, how do we explain that?
Actually, I think I have a solution for that, but I didn't think of it, regrettably. The solution is that a greater and greater fraction of the non-coding DNA is now recognized to, in fact, encode inhibitory RNA, which is not translated, but it serves as RNA that inhibits messenger RNA. So it has regulatory functions.
How's that? I know, it's not, it doesn't answer the question.
Do you know?
It doesn't answer the question in regards to the similarities.
If you look at DNA, let's say transposons. If you translocate the transposon to its new position, the consequences will be totally different, right? But that transposon has always been part of the original genome. In other words, it's part of who and what you are. The fact that it can transpose has nothing to do with evolution, because if the locus to which it transposes is just one nucleotide out, the rest would be gibberish, right? Because you're working on a triplet code. So it has to be an exact process. So even a thing like a transposon or heterochromatin or non-coding chromatin, all of these genes must have a particular function even if we don't understand it. Now in the beginning when we started arguing about transposons, this was the great new thing to favor evolution and to bring about rapid change. But the fact of the matter is, if the process of the transposon isn't absolutely precise, in other words, it has an element of design in it, if there's just one fraction deviation from the precision, you've got gibberish. It still smacks of design.
By evolutionists as a point in favor. The idea is, in times of crisis, might it be a temperature change, lack of food, all of a sudden, there's much more activity of transposons,
yes.
And all of a sudden, you might have also more mutations, and some of them might be beneficial for the next generation, and so you might have a shift, a DNA shift towards a certain direction in the next generation,
exactly.
Which will be more,
but here's
better,
the question,
better applied
here's
to
the question.
Their environment.
Is that evolution or is that design? Because that's Spalix. It's the most famous example of what you're talking about. Naked mole rats. In naked mole rats, there is a matriarch. She's the only one who reproduces, right? All the offspring. If the environmental conditions become hazardous, then all of a sudden there is a total rearrangement of the genome, and you have a massive diversity in the offspring, which in all other cases doesn't exist at all. There's hardly any diversity. Now, again, is that evolution, as you say, or is that built-in genetic variability and built-in mechanism to produce the variety to deal with the consequences of a changed environment? Didn't God use genetic engineering in the beginning? Did he use it, yes or no?
Yes.
On your belly you shall crawl. Thorns and thistles, it will produce.
But Darwin didn't write a book about the adaptation of species. He wrote a book about the origin of the species.
That's right.
So, you know, this business of using adaptation and extrapolating it to imply origins is a very bad line of argument.
Well, I understand them, because when I discuss it with them, and we can only go so far, but we cannot go really back to the very beginning. No. You know, you cannot really go to the laboratory, but we can observe as changes in,
that's right,
but we call microevolution, you know, or even...
It's not microevolution.
But we can see as small changes over time. Let's see, for example, grains. They are mice over time, very small, and it has, you know, humans bred it in a certain way. Now we have these nice big corns, or we have wheat, which is very nice. But, you know, over time it developed through our intervention into a specific product.
Personally, I don't believe in microevolution. I'm probably one of the few creationists who doesn't believe in microevolution. There's no such thing as microevolution. It's adaptation. It's adaptive change. But it always has to be built into the genetic system. It's not an evolution. It's a differential activation of gene patterns. And it has nothing to do with evolution. I think it's a very poor choice of word.
It's like antibody development against novel antigens or foreign problems that happen to hit our bodies. We can elaborate new antibodies until we find one that works. And then we select that one to store in memory cells, which will serve us in the future encounter of this same problem. But the whole mechanism of developing such antibodies is always there.
Was the capacity to get the varieties of all the fruits that we have there from the beginning, or did it come about by evolution? You can only draw out of the wild type what is potentially there. And you can draw it down through selective breeding to the smallest or to the largest, whatever, the sweetest or the bitterest, the sourest or the whatever. But it always had to be there. It's not an evolutionary process. And the changes that we see in bacteria and in wheat are as a consequence of transposons. But that is already existing bacteria that is compatibly spliced into a recipient. So again, it was already there. There's never any evolution. It's only rejuggling of what is already in existence.
I think I have a interesting way of thinking about that question, why the similarity? And it's just the simplistic way that I think about it for myself. And that's when people talk about the similarities between us and a chimpanzee, for example, it doesn't really tell us anything because we already know that chimpanzees look similar to us. Their eyes are in approximately the same place as ours are, their noses, their ears. They look, you know, 98% like us. So the fact that the DNA there is just kind of it's a no duh. I mean, we look like chimpanzees, they look like us.
Why is
so
the gibbon?
There's no.
You're right. Why is the gibbon considered more primitive?
Right.
Than
who made that
the chimpanzee?
Decision?
Just because he doesn't have the flat face, right? And his eyes are more on the side. What is the selective advantage, according to science, that the eyes move to the front, better triangulation? But these other organisms jump just as well without the triangulation. So there's no selective advantage. Have you ever seen a squirrel miss a branch? It doesn't, right? So it comes from the eye of the beholder. It's your paradigm that determines what is close.
I don't think you need a complicated discussion as to why the DNA similarity. It's just things that look similarly have similar DNA.
A classic example is when you look at the mammals. The rhinoceros is always classified as primitive. On what basis? On the basis of its paleontological position in the paleontological record? No. Because it's way there on top with everything else. On what basis is it primitive? Purely on appearance. Nothing else. Purely appearance. Which shows that the mindset of the scientist determines whatever the paradigm is he wants to project.
There are species of dinosaurs, for example, like Triceratops. If you look in the evolutionary paradigm, they have another species which they've named Protoceratops, completely arbitrarily. I mean, it looks like a Triceratops. It's just maybe a little fatter here, and it has a little shorter horn up front here, and they've decided that it's a more primitive version, just because that's what their paradigm says.
Or
there's
Ardi.
No.
You know Ardi? The latest Australopithecine that has been found, who now proves that we've come from the trees because he has a slightly longer digit length. I could take anyone in this audience and we could compare digit lengths, and I'm pretty sure we'll all differ.
Some of us are from three.
Exactly.
But primitivity doesn't make much sense because they can be as primitive as they want to be, but they are very well adapted to live.
Exactly. I'll give you a marvelous piece of evidence to shoot me down in the future. Lucy is classified as an intermediary on the basis of the ratio of arm to leg length. Apes have a ratio of 1:1. The arm is as long as the leg. Man has a ratio of 0.75:1. The arm is only 75% of the leg length. Lucy, although there are half the pieces missing, falls between the two, and I think it's 1:0.87 or something. Judged on what they see from the fragments, which nobody can calculate. So on that basis alone, she's an intermediary. Now, I've got news for you. Look at the length of my arms. They're exactly the same length as my legs. So you've got a monkey speaking to you.
I think
so you
have proven
evolution.
Yes.
I think we're ready to wrap up. If you have any more questions, I would invite you to come down and ask personally. I know some of you have to go back to work and go back to classes, but I would challenge you to fill this place tomorrow, to invite your friends, to drag your friends here from 12 to 1 tomorrow. We'll be, I understand we'll be back. Or
I will be giving a lecture tomorrow. Creation to restoration.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Just a few ideas, which I picked up from Adventist theistic evolutionists.
Would you like to close us out with prayer, Professor Veith?
Yes. Heavenly Father, you have never forced anyone to believe in you, trust in you, or walk with you. And you have given us all the evidence we require, and you have left a choice with us to decide which way we wish to go. But Lord, this is your institution. This is not just any institution. And so I pray that you will open the eyes of all of those who have claimed to be your followers, to follow you according to what you have written and not to what we think or surmise. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for your input. I like that.